thanks for joining us on City Talk. I'm Maria Serrao, filling in for Liz Brown Swanson, who's on vacation, and joining us, as he does every month, our mayor of Rancho Palos Verdes, Jerry Duhovic. Jerry, how are you?
I'm doing well, Maria. Thank you so much. It's great to have you here. Haven't had you for
a couple of years,
at
right?
At least. And I know you used to do that quite a bit, and yes. It's great to have you back.
Well, thank you. It's always fun to be here with you.
Well, you do a great job, not only here, you and Liz, out in the field. It's awesome. You do a great job. A lot of compliments on RPV-TV.
Thank you so much. It's so nice to hear that. I had a chance to see you the other day at 4th of July, which is always such a great event for the city.
It really was, and the weather cooperated. It turned about 12:30 and came back, and it was a nice turnout. There were several thousand people, and the music was great, and the esprit de corps and the camaraderie, the food was good.
That's right.
It was a 4th of July is a great day for everyone, I think.
No, it really is. And I know it's been such a busy summer and such a busy time for the city as well. Talking about some of these changes, we'll just jump right in.
Sure.
I know in June the city approved the fiscal year budget. What are the significant changes this year?
You know, Maria, the city, at least during my tenure, almost 8 years on council, though, we run a very conservative fiscal philosophy. And that was clearly evident this year also. Mm-hmm. We, as a council in March, challenged the city manager to come back with a reduction, and we threw out a number, $1 million.
Wow.
From the prior year's budget. And the caveat to that was that there were no reduction in city services or the ability to service our residents. And he went one better. He said, I'm going to shoot for $2 million. He told me off the record. And I said, well, you know, you do that, I'm going to get you whatever dinner you want, the most expensive dinner you want, we'll do it if you can get $2 million. And he came back and staff got $2.2
million
in reduction from the 18-19 budget to the 19-20 budget. It's amazing.
That's fantastic.
With the again, proviso that there's no reduction in services to residents. And mm-hmm. that really comes through technology. We've really embraced technology. Computer programming, you know, they always talk about people getting replaced by computers and stuff.
True.
It happens.
Yeah.
And I think we're going to be much more efficient in the coming year, and we've gotten better over the years. So excited about the budget process. Staff, all credit to Doug Wilmore and Gabby and Deborah Cullen, our Director of Finance.
They do a great job.
We are very, very lucky. We've got an excellent staff.
I know this is kind of a rough question, but is this the best group that you've had over all these years?
I think so. I really think so. I think they're dedicated. They're conscientious. They listen to what the council says. And that was one of the mantras that Doug Wilmore started with. He says, I do what you want me to do. You tell me what to do and get out of my way and I'll do it. And that's really what happens. So it makes serving on council a pleasure.
That's good. Yeah. That's good. Now, what about the capital improvement program? Is that going to be impacted by the changes?
No, not at all. All the budget reductions were absorbed by the general fund. Okay. And our CIP budget is about approximately $14 million. And, you know, it deals with our sewers and our infrastructure and everything. So we're solid there. And we've got a great committee. The IMAC helps us select what projects we're going to do from a capital improvement perspective. But we are, you know, knock on wood, we are a financially sound city, both in day-to-day operations and from a CIP perspective. I think, you know, we got the finest roads that I know of anywhere. If you really, even
they're
just,
great.
I don't want to say anything negative about our sister cities, but look at our roads to theirs. It's night and day. So anyway.
And what about the adequate reserves? I know it's always a big topic.
Reserves, and I have to take my hat off to prior councils. They set reserve policies in the past, and you know, most cities, Maria, they have ranges for reserve levels anywhere from 17 to 25. There's these GASB guidelines, and that's what they talk about. But, you know, we keep a 50% general fund reserve level, which is huge, and that's about $13.5 million. We also keep a healthy reserve in our capital improvement program budget, about $3 million. And I would be remiss and not to thank Terranea for the TOT. That helps out quite a bit.
Very
As
true.
I say very often, it makes our budgeting process that much easier because it's nice to have those additional funds, and they're continuing to do very well.
That's true. Yeah. Very true. Now, I've heard that there's some tax reductions for residents and businesses in the past few years. Can you comment on what they are?
You know, I take great pride in this, and thank you for bringing that up.
Sure.
This is one of my favorite things to talk about. I think we're probably the only city that can say we've reduced taxes over the last 8 years.
Yeah.
And that's the prior council and this council. Collectively, I'm going to rattle off a few of them here. Mm-hmm. You know, we've saved the city cumulatively Almost $8 million, and that has to do, we removed the telephone utility users tax, we sunset, allowed the storm drain user fee to sunset, we eliminated the landscape lighting district fee, we didn't increase the business license taxes, as you can with CIP, the Consumer Price Index. We also got rid of the home business license tax. It's a tax, they call it a fee, but it's a tax. And the other thing we did too, and this is number six, was the recycling fees. If you recall, the city used to capture those from EDCO. That's part of our contract. We rebate those back to residents. So we've literally cut taxes six times in this city in 8 years, which is unheard of in the state of California. Unheard of.
Nothing wrong with that.
So credit to all the members of the two councils.
That's very good. That's
absolutely.
Lower taxes are always a big win for residents, for sure.
Every little bit helps, and I think people appreciate the conscious stewardship of the city's finances.
Very true. Now, there was the city council awarded the construction contract for the first phase of the automatic license plate recognition project. Tell us where that is. That's the one along Western Avenue.
That's the last leg of the whole ALPR project. The entire hill basically uses that. If you really think about it, we have five or six major ingress routes to the entire peninsula. And the ALPR, exactly like it says, automatic license plate reader, these cameras read only the license plate. They don't get onto people's faces, but it's great for picking up stolen cars, people with outstanding warrants, other crime-solving issues. You know, they'll pick up, there'll be a crime, and this license was noted in a crime either in RPV or somewhere else. And then it also helps, too, when we have to. You know, we've had over the years, I know there's been a couple elderly people that got lost and drove around aimlessly, and we were able to pick them up, too, and assist them with their family. So they're very appreciative of that. But this closes that network. Western is a lot more difficult. There's actually four or five different egresses or ingresses onto the peninsula. So we have to put a few more cameras over there. And we didn't have the ability to get the infrastructure where we needed it until we bought all the streetlights from Southern California Edison, which was a great move on our part. And now that allows us to mount cameras because those are ours. We couldn't do it before, and we can tap into the electrical there. So we will have a closed net on the peninsula. And the ALPR program has been just a monumental success. It is, you know, I get texts all the time as a city council member, this happened, this happened, this happened. And the ALPRs play a big, big part in that.
And kind of amazing to think of when that started on the cars, on the sheriff's
cars.
That's
right.
And now it's just turned into such a wonderful tool to help, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, and a lot of cities have embraced it, and they saw what we did. And thank you to our sister cities on the Hill, because it really wouldn't work if it was just us. We were able to get them on board, and their councils thought it was a good thing, and I think they're probably just as happy as we are.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Being safe is never a bad thing, right?
That's priority one, job one.
That's true. Now, the city council heard from sheriff and fire regarding wildfire prevention emergency protocol. We just had some earthquakes, so what can you tell us about what was discussed?
Well, first of all, our sheriff department and the fire department do a great job.
They do.
Outstanding individuals, and you know, they put their life on the line on a regular basis for our safety, and a lot of time go unrewarded. So thank you to them on behalf of the council and the residents, et cetera. They really, and you think about how chaotic life would be without them. It would be a nightmare.
Yep.
But there are many programs. Both the sheriff and the fire department work together. The fire department has a kind of a standard program that they call Ready, Set, Go, and it talks about how you deal with fire situations and wildfire situations and what you should do. There was actually several different, our website has a lot of material on it, and it talks about things like removing combustible material from your house, around your house. One of the big things we have is, you know, too, with all the rain we have all this overgrowth not necessarily just weeds, but just growth. Combustible growth is starting to turn yellow. It was beautiful there for about 2 weeks, and it looked all flowery now. And the goats are busy, and we have instructed staff that no matter what it takes, we need to get that foliage and that cleared out, because it's a major fire hazard, and it's everywhere. You had mustard plants, you know, 10 feet high over there, and it's butting up against people's houses. It's in the preserve. So it's actually, there's another agenda item coming up at our next meeting where we're going to talk about a little closer collaboration, if we can kill two birds with one stone with the Conservancy. But we are hitting it hard, and staff got the message. We want the combustible material removed ASAP, and it may turn out to be a year-long endeavor going forward. You know, it used to be after the season, right before summer, we did it and we were done, but it doesn't look that way because there's just so much of it out there.
Right.
It may be a nonstop deal.
And so. We recently worked with Andy Alvera from the fire department, Captain Andy Alvera.
Sure.
He did three or four PSAs with us talking about the brush clearance, making sure your smoke alarms are working.
I saw those, yeah.
Just so great that, you know, they really do go above and beyond for sure.
And the good news is we have a very conscientious, you know, citizenry out there. They call and they call me, they call staff and say, hey, I got brush that's butting up against my house.
Yep.
I need somebody to come take care of it. So, you know, we attack those pretty clearly. The other big component that we've gotten lately, Maria, is people are concerned about evacuation because I mentioned earlier we got four or five major egress routes at this point in the case of a big disaster.
Right.
And they're saying, well, what are the escape routes? And the message that came through, because it, for some reason, those things, I don't know if it was on Nextdoor or YouTube or whatever, it was like, how do we get off the hill in case of an emergency, an earthquake or a fire or whatever? And the message is this. It depends where the emergency is and what the emergency is. The sheriffs and the fire department, believe it or not, practice.
They do, for sure.
They practice and they say, this is how we're going to move people. If this particular area is affected, we're going to take this route, and this, so you're going to block this street so we can get people moving quickly, et cetera, et cetera. So they're on top of it, but the bottom line message is it is really incident dependent as to what those routes are going to be. Everyone should hopefully be familiar with the hill and how you normally get off and on, and please follow the directions of our safety and first responders, because that it is imperative. We've had examples, and again, as a councilperson, you read this, maybe you read some of this stuff, but you know, the Woolsey fire, you know, there were two or three families that were decimated because they did not listen to law enforcement. They went the opposite way, and guess what? They drove right into the fire and they perished.
Yes.
So if, and there's another one. People didn't evacuate when they told you to evacuate. You know, there's no mandatory evacuation. If they tell you to get out, get out. They're not telling you to get out because, you know, it's convenient for them. It's a safety issue. So they tell you to get out, get out.
Well, safety for yourself, obviously, but even breathing in the smoke. The smoke inhalation is horrible after a fire. We had gone out to some of the Woolsey fire area, and people just don't realize that it will affect them physically. They've got to go. That's why they're telling them to leave.
Well, not only that, they got these things. You know, when you've got canyons and stuff around there, they call it the chimney effect.
Exactly.
Hot air, hot gases. Yes. You don't even see them coming, and they'll come whipping through and burn you, scald you. You know, it's. If there's a fire, get away as
quickly
and efficiently and as safely as possible. But the other thing I did want to mention, a couple other, you know, we work very closely, obviously, with the LA County Fire Department, the Department of Agriculture, the Palos Verdes Conservancy, you know, because we do have thousands of acres in the preserve. So that's a big one that's on our heads, too. But we work very closely with them. And that is an area that people are very concerned about because that catches.
Right.
You remember 09, thank God we didn't have winds. If we had winds, it could have been catastrophic.
And so. I think you're probably hearing from our residents because of the recent earthquakes that people are feeling. And
absolutely.
They're starting to think, do I have the water? Do I have everything I need?
Well, you know, the good news is we have the Cal Water project where we're finally getting new piping to make sure we do have that water to get the water up the hill, because then it's gravity fed on the way down. And if you haven't noticed, you know, our well, it's, I guess it's not our reservoir, but I'll take credit for it. Our reservoir is coming back. I used to love that thing. I always wondered why it was empty, but no, they've been working hard, and that thing's going to be full pretty soon. So we will have some water in the close proximity to Rancho Palos Verdes. So
very good.
We could very easily, unfortunately, become an island unto ourselves in a major emergency.
Very true. So, very true. Now, the City Council recently initiated a code amendment proceedings regarding the accessory dwelling units. What does that mean? Tell us what that means.
You know, we've talked about that several times. The it's an important deal, and this has to do with the state mandating things that used to be city business, and we used to be able to control that, set our own ordinances, set our own rules, et cetera, et cetera. Now the mandates are coming from on high, and they're coming fast and furious. This one here basically says you need to allow you, the city, need to allow your residents to build an auxiliary dwelling unit. Granny flat, second home, whatever you want to call it, they mandate, they basically say you cannot enforce city setbacks, you can't enforce parking issues, garage issues, all these different things, and your failure to comply will subject your city to dealing with the Attorney General of the state. So it was a big cram down. What we did as a council is we looked at that and voluntarily modified our ordinances to comply with the state rules and set up the processes for residents to actually apply and get a permit and maintain some control of that whole ADU process and permitting process. And it's worked. We actually, one of the very first ones out of the chute, I won't mention who it was, but it was this big grandiose thing, and we took care of that pretty quickly.
Great.
So, yeah. You don't want people's views being blocked. You don't want big box structures in what used to be your neighbor's backyard. So
exactly.
We're working hard to deal with the state and actually comply with the law. So
that's good. And of course, the city council received a report on the city's ongoing implementation of both the coyote management plan and the peafowl management. That is always such a huge topic with residents.
It is. And what's interesting is where we live now, we never really had peacocks near us, and now we hear them, and we enjoy it. It's not overbearing, but you hear them at night, you hear them in the morning, but they're everywhere.
Yes, they are.
My understanding is that the herd on the the entire peninsula is somewhere around 2,000 to 2,500 birds.
Right.
And the city of RPV, again, being the first to lead the charge, was the first one to come up with a peafowl trapping program. I think we did that in 13, was the first year. And we successfully humanely trap, and relocate about 150 to 200 birds, depending on the census. We take account of the birds. We do a census.
Where do they go when you relocate?
You know, there are multiple reserves and farms that they go out to, primarily in the desert. There are a couple names here. I can look for you because we have some notes here. But they go out to, they go out to Ventura County, San Diego County, Kern, and San Bernardino. So I guess they like it warm out there, but they are clearly that was a big thing for residents and for the council. We wanted to make sure they weren't euthanized or anything like that and treated very well, and nothing but rave reviews. I haven't heard a complaint about peafowl literally probably in 3 or 4 years.
That's great. No, and I know some residents who told me they had the humane traps and they were working great. So
there's 7 or 8 strategic neighborhoods. I know, like Vista Grande and Crest Ridge and Sunnyside Ridge area, that the birds tend to congregate, and we're able to thin the herd pretty efficiently.
That's good.
Yeah.
Now, you're busy all the time, and last night you attended a workshop for the Ladera Linda Park and Community Center project.
I did.
Tell us about that, how it's going.
Well, that was probably one of the largest audiences of residents that we have. Probably, I'd guess maybe 100, 100 plus people in there. It went very well, Maria. This is probably my, I'd say, 8th or 10th meeting on this particular topic. Ladera Linda is near and dear to a lot of people's hearts.
Sure.
It was a school. A lot of people's kids went there. Mm-hmm. But the school is 50 years old now at this point, and it's in dire need of being torn down and replaced. And the question is, what do you replace it with? Mm. And the primary issue that everyone needs to understand is there's one way in and one way out, up for a stall. And you think about all our other parks. All our other parks are on major thoroughfares, Hawthorne Boulevard, Ryan Park, Hess Park. You got PV Drive South, the little parks we have over here. The preserve even has at least somewhat of an arterial effect to get to. But this is one two-lane road in and out that leads to a neighborhood. So they are very, very concerned on what's going on there. We've morphed into a destination city.
Yes.
They're worried about we build it and they will come. So we want to build something nice. We want to service our residents. We want to service the entire population from an age perspective, from kids all the way up to seniors.
Sure.
And all that was taken into consideration. And the architect, Jonathan Favaro, has done a great job implementing everything that not only the councilors, I've spoken with them personally 3 or 4 times, implementing our ideas, the community's ideas, et cetera. You can't please everyone.
No.
The majority of the feedback last night was very, very positive. There's a little bit of concern about, and all valid because it was not addressed, security. Is it going to be a closed park? Is it going to be fenced? Are there going to be cameras? You know, what about the size of the rooms? What are we going to do there? Are you going to have a full-blown kitchen? Are you going to have a little warming station? Are you going to host wet? All these different things.
So many things I don't think people think about. There's many things to think about there.
They broke the 100-plus people into 6 or 7 groups, and they all had big white pads, and they all had, here's what we think is good, and here's what we think you should consider. And there were very good ideas there.
That's great.
Yeah, so hopefully they will take all that back. It's coming back to the council on, I think, the second meeting in August. But we're going to make some decisions fairly quickly. But everything I really appreciate and always have, the feedback of our residents is very important.
Yes.
Because, you know, we can't think of everything as a council. And
that's
the feedback. And there were some excellent ideas last night. So I'm hoping everyone will be happy when it's all said and done, or at least the majority of the people.
Well, it's nice that you're getting the help from the public as well, residents.
Yeah, they're very, and obviously those that live very nearby are very, very concerned, and they should be.
Very true. Now, July is Park and Recs Month. What did Rec and Parks do to kick off this special month for the city?
Well,
residents,
you talked about the 4th of July.
Yes.
There was a couple thousand people, and it always is, and the kids have a great time.
It is so much fun.
You know, the patriotic music is great, and like I told you in my little interview there, you know, you get to see people you don't necessarily see all the time,
which is so nice.
It is nice, and we haven't had much of a summer up until then too. It kind of really kicked off a day or
pretty
two
true.
Right before there, right? You know, summer started first week of July for RPVs.
That's right.
But it was great. You know, they staff does a great job. It went off without a hitch. Mm-hmm. You know, they had a nice agenda, and we got to recognize our new police captain,
yes.
Jim Powers, and he seems like a great guy. And you know, it was a good day for families.
That's right. And I think that we just get busier and busier and busier, so it's nice to have that one day where we can just kind of stop and just relax and enjoy, you know, company.
I agree. It was very casual, very, very, as I always say too, we're a large city in geography and number of people, but that was a really small hometown feel to it.
Very true.
And kids love it. And then we also had, moving on to that,
yeah.
We had the 4th of July Bark Party at Eastview. And I will tell residents, if you haven't been to Eastview Park, if you have a dog, you want a beautiful dog park.
Go there.
Go to Eastview. That dog, you know, you think about a dog party. There were 400 dogs there, okay? And the people loved it. They enjoyed it, and it is probably one of the finest dog parks I've seen.
Dog parks have kind of become a thing in the last, I think, 20 years. Everybody's always going to dog parks.
They're a very social
place.
My brother-in-law, we have two little dogs, and he is now goes on a daily basis to one of the dog parks. I'm like, are you going to the dog? Oh, I love it. Yeah, the dogs play. I get to talk to the people.
Yeah.
So it's great.
It's a social environment.
It is.
Yeah.
And there was a concern when we first did we were the first one to do the temporary dog park right here on
That's
the City Hall Civic
always
Center.
Crowded.
Always crowded.
Always crowded.
But it's really for the residents, and the residents get it. We don't have, you know, the concern was you're going to have people coming from all over out of town to come to this park, and that really hasn't come to fruition.
No. So. But sometimes I think I see more residents there than I do their dogs.
And that's true, too.
I think this is a meeting place now.
It is. Absolutely.
It's
so
fun,
that worked out well. Mm-hmm. And then what else did we have? We had
we were going to talk about the last
Shakespeare, right?
Yes.
Well, go ahead. I didn't mean to
interrupt
you.
Last year we did the 45th anniversary concert in the summer in the park. And
right.
What are we doing this year?
Well, we're going to do another concert. That was a huge success last year.
Yep.
And, you know, there's going to be a free beach-themed concert this year for the date exactly is July 27th.
Okay.
From 12 to 4 at Upper Point Vicente. And I will give the lineup. The opening band is Megan the Bandits.
Oh.
And followed by a kid-centric performance by Kids Imagination. So there's everything for all the families. And this band I've heard many times, the main band, they're called the Wingtips. They're actually from the east side of the hill in San Pedro. They actually opened up for the Beach Boys at the USS Iowa last summer. So
and we have a lot of talented people here, musicians on the hill.
We really do.
We
there's
do.
Just the talent and the expertise and everything we have on the hill. We got some smart people around
we
here.
We do. Smart and talented.
But there'll be food trucks and kid zones and the whole, you know, family fun. And the other thing I wanted to mention is we did have Shakespeare in the Park, and that was the Comedy of Errors, and that was on the City Hall site, and we had 350 people there, too. So the city, Rec and Parks does a great job. They really do.
And thank goodness, because like we were talking about being busy. Jerry, when do you have time to get out with your own family? Things are so busy.
It's very precious. It is very busy. You know, if you do the council job right, it's busy. I'm busy with my own business.
Right.
And, you know, my daughters are 18 and 15. One's going off to college.
Amazing.
And, it is challenging, but it is a lot of fun. And this is the world we live in. It's not just me. It's everybody.
It really is. Know? It's true.
And I do think people lament that a little bit. And I get it because, you know, I shouldn't even say, I can't really even remember when I sat down between 5 and 6 for dinner with my family. It just doesn't happen.
Well, you kind of go on maybe, you know, ups and downs of that. So maybe next year will be a little bit, you know.
We'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see. I hope so. But, you know, there's trade-offs for that. And we don't.
There is.
We can talk about that
philosophically
later. Yeah. That's completely different. That's right.
All right, Jerry. Well, thank you so much for taking the time, as always, to come here and kind of update us on everything, explain things in a little bit more detail. And we will look forward to having you next month.
Great to have you. Anytime you want to come fill in.
Okay.
Love to see you.
Thank you, Jerry. Well,
I'll
see you next month. How's that?
Hey, that's even better. That's right. Okay. We'll see you then.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Maria Serrao, and we'll see you next time on City Talk.